All right, so Sridhar, are they here? Ajishman, right? Come down now. All right, okay. Argadeep, Ankit, and Shawa. And while they are setting up, people who have not sent in the PDFs of their posters, please do it immediately. And we can only print A4, not A0. Remember that.
Hi, my name is Argadeep. How does it work? Okay. So my group members are Ankit and Shao Hua. So we kind of wanted to look at, you know, what kind of growth patterns we see inside our host when the bacteria is infecting, bacteria or virus. It's a general model very much. So we looked at the competition. So in one of the experimental, you know, a few experimental papers, they count only the infected number of cells, and that growth log kind of turns out to be logistic. I had this question, okay, how does it actually, you know, so there are some special, you know, restrictions. So one is limited resource, limited space, there is immune response, and the sheer fact that, you know, an infected cell can only infect a susceptible cell which is already not infected. So that the origin of the logistic growth can be actually explained by a simple contact process, is that, you know, you have infected cell. Now, if the neighbor is not infected, then it infects. If it's already infected, nothing happens, and there is a death rate. You can actually write down a mean field model for that, and you know it's sort of logistic in a sense, and with an R of A minus B. So we kind of, you know, try to look at the immune response itself. So X is infected cells. In all the plots, it'll be blue. T is killer cells. Right now, I can actually, I'm not going to define whether it's a immune cell or, you know, I artificially put some drug, because, and C is actually infected, you know, killer cell complex, intermediate complex. So, okay, so the process is basically this. X goes to 2X with a rate of alpha, that is the, you know, birth rate. And this is the process where actually the infected cell, you know, the infection is decaying. So this part goes to a, you know, complex, intermediate complex with a K1 rate, and then goes to a, you know, T plus dead rate. So okay, so I omitted the DC DT because that's just minus DT DT. So this part is logistic, just growth, and minus, you know, this part, and this is just, you know, this and this. So okay, so this is you know, okay, so this is the infection. It goes to zero and A. With for some parameter value mu that I'm going to define in the next slide. So what happens is that you have this very complicated A, so I'm going to simplify it a little bit. So let's assume that, you know, we are almost near the steady state, and the number of T is more or less same. And one more assumption is that the complex, intermediate complex, is very short-lived, and they, in, you know, both put together, you know, you know, make an immune reservoir. So assuming this, you kind of get this, and you plug in the, you know, this thing and this thing, and you get that. So it boils down to this one equation essentially in the steady state. Okay, so I'm going to actually simplify this a little more with just, you know, a few rescaling and A.
Sorry,
what's P? Sorry? Oh, P is the total immune reservoir, the T plus the complex itself. So because if you, in experiment, if you, you know, tag them, so if it's a protein, it can, you know, show up in both places. So you can't really recognize very well. And it's a short-lived thing. So yeah, so DTDT is kind of constant itself.
So basically, there is a logistic growth for X.
Yes.
Quality,
yes.
And there is a
Michaelis-Menten
type quantification.
Yes, the Michaelis-Menten time only shows up because, okay, so the basic model is this. So Michaelis-Menten type shows up because the T actually goes to a kind of a constant value, and the C itself is short-lived, and the total thing is constant. So I rescaled it and made, you know, it's a simpler equation. Now the trivial solution to this is actually X star is equal to zero, which will mean that it's infection-free. Now the non-trivial solutions are these two. Okay, so the trivial solution becomes stable only, you know, the if you do the linear stability. So you just, you know, take the first the x derivative of this, and at x naught, x star is equal to zero, you make sure that this has to be less than zero. So that actually transformed to this condition that mu greater than one. Okay, so the mu is actually important. It's k1p by alpha. So it's going to show up later. So you kind of, you know, if you do a, you know, simulation, it kind of shows like this. So at mu is equal to exactly one, it actually drops. This is a, you know, unstable A. So okay, so there is one more thing that happens is that when actually these things show up, essentially. So for negative values, we actually ignore because it's biologically irrelevant. So this part cannot be imaginary. So 1 plus theta squared has to be greater than 4 theta mu. So okay, so for theta, some value. So this is for theta value 1.5. Okay, you just get once A, and here is a critical transition. And the theta for 0.5, you kind of get a bistability. Now you can actually see that for, you know, theta greater than one, you, the negative values are ignored, and you know there's a critical transition at mu is equal to one. For theta is less than one, both solutions exist only if this is true. So this thing I'm gonna call mu tilde. So I actually get two kinds of, you know, critical values. One is mu c and one is mu tilde. Now if you plot the phase diagram, so this is, you know, kind of monostable infection, and you get a you know transition from here to there. And actually, the here you get a bistability, but I won't emphasize on it much because, you know, it can be simply from the model. Okay, so so the result. So the basic prediction is that the mu has to be greater than one to be infection free. So if you look closely, this is the rate at, you know, killing the, you know, infected cell, and this is the total immune reservoir, and this is actually the rate at actually the infection is growing. So essentially 1 by mu is practically the basic reproductive ratio of the infection's growth. Okay, so actually the fields of pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics actually exist to actually calculate this value. Yeah, how do I actually find this value exactly and then, you know, design drugs? So for the application part, we kind of define, we'll extend it to this thing, that this is the, you know, the lowest steady state concentration of a drug. Because you inject them intravenously, they're just exponential decays, and they'll go to an oscillatory steady state. The lower bound is, let's say, F. There is an efficacy, and this is rescaling due to, you know, with this. And this is the same thing. So this is basically a very childish toy model, I guess. But yeah, we kind of give you a sort of idea of what you should, you know, look for when you're designing drugs or just looking at, you know, where to actually, you know, intervene, probably this place. Yeah.
Questions?
Just a small question. Yeah. When I was seeing your model. So since you never in the end had much role for this the carrying capacity, I was wondering if you just have exponential growth, would you see a very similar phase diagram, or would it be very different?
No, so the
how crucial is the logistic growth part of this?
So I kind of have a feeling that the logistic growth is just because you have the space involved.
And sure, but what I meant is, if for some reason you're very far from carrying capacity, or carrying capacity is not important, would the phase diagram be very different? What's your intuition?
Oh, so okay. So actually, the phase. If you look at the phase diagram, okay, sorry. This theta. I mean, when you're just looking at this part, when the theta is quite high itself, that means, you know, I mean, this part is irrelevant. You know, this can jump from infection free to monostable infection, and it. Now the theta is actually, you know, scales with 1 by k. So if theta high, that means the carrying capacity is very low. So it kind of, if the carrying capacity is quite high for the virus, it kind of means that you're in this range. So the, either the infection is in a bistable state or a monostable state, but the carrying capacity being high essentially means that the infection will survive. Yeah. So I think that's where the carrying capacity shows up.
Okay. Thank them. Okay. Is Upanishad Sharma, Dibendu Datta, and Saurabh? Hello.
Yeah, so I'm Upanishad, and other members are Saurabh and Dibendu. So here we are modeling the genetic divergence in Hodgkinia lineage in cicadas of different nymph states. So cicada is a moth. So this is cicada, which is a sap-sucking insect, which sucks sap from the plant, and there's gut bacteria in it, which manage it out. So yeah, these are the facts about cicada, that cicada are moths with multi-stage life cycle, where there are mainly three stages: egg, then the nymph, which is an underground stage, and then an adult. So nymph stage has different durations, 1 year, 3 year, 7 year, and so on. So this in one way is a predator avoiding way in which these insects have evolved. Then the endosymbionts inside their guts provide cofactors and amino acids during their development when they are in the nymph stage underground. And
I understand that 2, 4, 5, etc. are missing from this?
Yes. These are basically majority of prime number years that they have their this thing, so that they can avoid the predators. Yeah. So then these are the two main kinds of endosymbiotic bacteria in cicada, and this is one specific species which we'll be dealing with, which has a 13-year long life cycle. So in introduction, there's a recent paper in PNAS by Campbell et al. Where they have shown the splitting of Hodgkinia genome into multiple new chromosomes inside the 13-year long life cycle cicada, with some of them have split such that they are still in discrete cells, but they are complementing each other. The genome. I'll show you how it happens. And the result of it is a net tenfold increase in the Hodgkinia genome in the terms of nucleotides. Yeah, so this is how it happens. These two are the 1 year long life cycle. This is the 3 years long life cycle. And these are the divisions that have happened in the 13-year old life cycle. So you can see the purple genes, methionine producing genes. Oh. These are purple. These are supposed to be purple. These are not red always. All of them. This is purple actually. Yeah. So these are this is how it has split. But still, these are some of them have clubbed together in a cell, and still they are complementing. So our model, which Saurabh is going to explain you, is to address this, how this happens and what this is going to do.
So essentially the. We would like to explain is that in the short life cycle cicadas, you don't see the endosymbiont genomes splitting into different lineages. So you have only one sort of genome. In intermediate life cycle, you get two division into two genomes, and then with very long life cycles, you get divisions into. So the same paper proposes a verbal sort of explanation, and the idea is that since this is the case where the life cycle is 1 year intermediate and then very long life cycles. And the idea is that there is less time for neutral evolution to happen in this case, and therefore you cannot arrive at these combinations. So basically, all the endosymbiont genomes together have to make the full complement of metabolites, otherwise the host does not survive. So the idea is that here you do not get that kind of complementation to evolve, and the only cicadas that survive are the ones which have the endosymbiont, which produces all the metabolites. But in the case where you have where the cicadas spend a long time underground, the endosymbionts have a longer duration to spend in neutral evolution, and they can develop these complementarities in their genomes. And if one So, for example, if you get one kind of a mutant, lineage, then there is another lineage of the endosymbiont which produces the product which this cannot produce, and so they complement each other, and that's how you get a diversity of genomes. So the question, okay, yeah, so this is just a cartoony representation. So the question is, what kind of parameter values do you need for such, you know, so this evolves over millions of years. And then one thing which is not clear is whether the presence of two lineages in the intermediate life cycle host is some kind of a steady state, or it's going to diverge as time passes. So that's one question. And if it is a steady state, then what kind of parameter combinations can give you a steady state where with that life cycle you get only two lineages, and then when the life cycle increases you get many lineages. So of course we haven't been able to answer that question, but the question is it possible to achieve stable genome divergence or fragmentation with some models of neutral evolution and some bottlenecks which happen from one generation of host to the next.
So what we assumed is that there's neutral evolution taking place, and which is explained modeled via Moran process. So a Moran process is essentially where there's asynchronous reproduction taking place in the population, where one individual is selected based on fitness, and then that produces a progeny which may be a mutant or not a mutant. And then it replaces another randomly selected individual from the population. So this is how a Moran process progresses. For a nymph with a small life cycle, we assume that we start from a uniform polyploid genome. This is what the paper proposes, that we start with polyploids. So our modeling, we started whether this is even possible, with whether this assumption of polyploidy is necessary. So what we started initially was we did some simulations with monoploids, and we tried this simulation in a Moran process with many different numbers of parameters, but we still see that in most cases, even though the number of mutants which are produced in the population, say the population size was 3,000, the number of mutants in the population, most of them are small in number, but quite a few of them still are large in number. So if you have such a system, you will, over time, the genetic variation will build up, and you will not be able to sustain a stable genetic variation in the same. So we kind of come to the conclusion that polyploidy is probably necessary for this stable symbiosis to continue. So in these models, we need to have uniform polyploid genomes. We start for the 1 year, and it's a low lifespan, so low amount of variation is there. And so yeah, we wanted to try the parameter space, but in case of long life cycles, we need to start with, after evolving the first one, whatever, if we evolve the first one for a really long time, and if we get to see lineages happening, that as a starting point for the long lifespans, we could see if this is again stabilizing or diverging more or not. And if divergence at this higher level needs additional factors like increased mutation rates or additional constraints or not. So the modeling with, so these are the few parameter sets which we use for the single models. What we assumed is 5 to 10 chromosomes, 100 genes per chromosomes, and so on. But we were not able to successfully run that code as of now. So the modeling considerations are, is there an apparent benefit for the genome to fragment? We cannot see that generally. What we could assume is that if these genomes are probably fragmented, then what would happen is that since the organism would not have to produce those gene products, then it would have a certain growth advantage. But what kind of, but then that would be subject to a bottleneck of complementarity, and only then would the symbiosis exist. Otherwise, they would lose out during ovarian transmission. Also, is this a unique property? So is this a unique property of the Hodgkinia? Because in Celsia, the same conditions exist, but it does not happen. And additionally, which could affect this process is that if in an organism which has a really long lifespan, are there metabolic changes happening in the organism which lead to additional level of selection of these genomes, which would explain the such a wide variety of these fragmentation of genomes. So that's kind of it. Thanks.
It's a very interesting system, but there's one bit that I haven't got my head around. What is the nature of the bottleneck that happens when the cicada wakes up and reproduces? It seems like you're saying somehow the endosymbionts go through some kind of population bottleneck. Their population reduces a lot or something. I didn't fully understand that.
Is that these are inside the organism, and through the process of transovarian transmission, random samples of these organisms will be transferred to the eggs. So they will pass through the body fluids and get transferred and randomly get deposited in different eggs. Now, whichever egg is going to successfully have a complementary set of these different Hodgkinia lineages will give rise to successful surviving progenies. Now, in order for this symbiosis to be a stable point, this needs to be done very reliably over different generations. If the genetic variation is such that it leads to such fragmentations where complementarity is not maintained, then most of the progenies of the cicada will die, and the Hodgkinia would also die with it. Yeah. It's underground. Yes. Yeah. What is the probability of getting a complement, a set which is complements each other completely? Right.
And if now, you don't get that in some small random sample, that cicada dies. Or that
doesn't have any. So essential aim of the simulation would be to get a probability distribution which shows maximum amount of complementary, and the chance of getting non-complementary sets reduces very much. That would lead to a stable system. Otherwise, it would collapse. This symbiosis would collapse.
Okay, let's thank them. So let's break for coffee now, and we resume at 11:30. Then the group of Nayan, Madhulika, and Narmada will take over. And one more thing, if you haven't sent the posters for printing, do it immediately. We can't print it after lunch. So the group of Nayan, Madhulika, and Narmada can come down. So next is Dolly Mehta, Soumya, Tanvi, Zara, and Kalyani.
Sometimes it's not audible.
Hello. Good morning, everyone. Topic of our presentation is search for alternate routes. So the motivation is that we all know that the alternate pathways do exist in the nature. We have lots of the biological example for that. As for example is the signaling pathways, metabolic graphs. But what we lack is that we don't have... search for alternate routes. Yeah, Mayank and Narmada, since she is not well, so she hasn't come today. Nayan. Okay, so what we lack is that we don't have a method which can identify a relevant route for a given condition. So, for example, we can see here, suppose we are looking for the target which is a POP1, and the information can go through all different routes. But we don't have any method, computational methods basically, which can identify what route is happening in for a particular given condition. So the question what we have asked is that because of the lots of computational efforts, we have lots of network kind of structure present for lots of different conditions. But we don't know that how to, decompose this graph so that we can get pathway specific information that in what condition canonical pathways is happening or non-canonical pathways is happening. So what we asked is that, what we try to do is that we try to design a computational framework which can identify relevant routes for a given particular condition. So this is the overall workflow what we have designed. So this is the with the demograph result I am showing, and I'm going to keep using these slides further onwards. So we have used this demograph, and when you take a graph, and what you try to identify is we want to identify the what are the alternate routes. So first you have to know that what all routes can exist for a given condition, or for all the possible conditions. So for that we have used the depth first search algorithm, which can list all possible routes which can which is possible in for this given network. What trick we have used here is that when you use the depth first search algorithm, so it's a very basic algorithm which has been used for so many other things. So you will start traveling from a node one, and you want to know that for all possible other nodes, in what other ways it is possible. So it's a very intensive process if it is not a directed graph. So what we use that we have used the directed graph. So the reverse flow of information is not possible. So for a given graph, you compute all paths which is possible, and then you take only those paths for only those pair of the source and targets, means particular, in this case, gene or protein, for which the alternate path is existing, because we are wanted to list out only for those interactions for which the alternate pathways is possible. We are not interested in for the direct transfer of the information. And then we use the gene expression data to compute for each of these paths the what is the cost of that particular path. And for that we have used that suppose this for this path there are three genes FHM. We use the cumulative score of gene expression of these three genes, and we have given the 1 by of the cumulative of the gene screen, because what we say is that what we want to say that the path cost should be least for a particular given condition, then only that path is significant. And then we have ranked the path, and from those things we are trying to explore what are the possible alternate routes can be possible for a given condition. So this was a demograph what we used. Coming to the biological data set example, so yeah. So this I have shown is the actually demograph for which I have written the, means we have written the codes and all. For the real biological network, we have used the protein information. So the real biological data set is this.
No, so the nodes are what?
Protein.
But the proteins are interacting, you know, I mean the protein-protein interactions are typically
bidirectional,
right?
No. You have assigned, you can assign the direction of the protein-protein interaction. It's not always the bidirectional.
What does it mean? Having a directional interaction between one protein and another? What's the nature of the interaction that you're talking about?
See, suppose protein A can interact with protein B. So it's like a protein-protein interface, suppose you have. And suppose this is a protein A and this is a protein B. So direction of the interaction between the the residues which are at the interacting phase, we can determine those things. Those things are present in the literature. And you have a database also where you can grip out only for the directed, for which you have assigned the direction. There is a method to assign the direction for the protein-protein interaction.
Can this be done for all protein-protein?
No. It's,
there are some, obviously, it's just a bond between the proteins. You would imagine that.
Yeah. We can't do it for all the proteins actually. So suppose you have 100 protein-protein complex, we have are actually right now are able to only assign for 30 to 40% proteins, those pairs. We are not able to assign for everything. Okay, I can explain in the very simplified way. Suppose you take a signaling pathways. Okay. So what I have taken is a very small system because we wanted to test this method. So I have taken a C. elegans and the data I have collected from the signal link, and we have altogether 247 interactions and these number of the genes. what we have considered is only the directed protein-protein interactions and the transcriptional regulation, because we know that the direction is from the TF2 target gene. And this was our network. So first we looked at the network properties, and I will tell these are the basic properties of the network, and this is the characteristic path length distribution of the shortest path. This is very important to understand that we can see the distribution is maximum till 5 length of 5 and 6. So what we have taken is that when you use the depth first search algorithm, so that it's a tree based structure. So you can go deep down, deep down, deep down. So, and we don't know the what is the biological significance of that to and it's a computationally intensive process also. To keep, to you know, to minimize this effort, what we have taken is that we have taken a cutoff of the path length 6, because we don't want to search further more than that. We don't want to look for the path which has a path length of 12, 13, 14, because we can't actually validate those, you know, path length in a real scenario. So this was our input. We have taken a directed graph. Path length cutoff we have taken a 6. And we have implemented the network X in the network X. So altogether from this 247, so you can understand what is the how much it is intensive process that it has only 247 interactions. And at the output, what we have got is around 5,000 paths. For around 1,051 source target pair, we have got for which there was lots of alternate paths. So further, we have considered only those means, and only from this set, we are taking our further analysis. So I'm coming back to again these things, because now we are, so this was like unweighted graph. We have not given any biological information, no gene expression data, only that static graph. Now we are calculating the path cost for a given condition. So for the data set, I have taken a GAC, this data set, which has a control and treatment. And only one thing I want to amplify, that the treatment condition was the overexpression of the BAR1 gene. And we can understand the significance here is that, look at this here. So the BAR1, actually, the target of the BAR1 is the POP1 gene, which if it binds, it will be the activation of this process, further process. So what we try to look at is that information of the POP1, we are running out of the time, so we just took one path in which the target was the POP1, the final POP1, and we try to look at that what all the pathways can exist. So we have taken one path in which, so there is one problem that all of these are the UniProt ID. So suppose this is actually a POP1 and this is one the source target gene, I will come to that. So for this path, for this source to target, there was around 12 paths it was existing. We have computed the weights for all the paths, for these 12 paths, both for the treatment and the control condition, and then we ranked them. So we can see that the top rank in the control was path 9 and path 1, and here the treatment, it was path 11 and path 3. If you see the biological relevance of this, in the treatment condition, the information from the PIR1 gene to the POP1, it always go through by BAR1. While if you look at in the control condition, it always go through that LIT1 gene. So this is the biological information which is existing in the literature, that all of these are different variant of the Wnt signaling, and we were looking at the target, downstream target, transcription target for the POP1. And what we have validated here is that in the control condition, it's happening through the canonical variant of the, it's a variant of the canonical pathways where it is happening through the LIT1 gene. While if you look for the treatment condition, where there is BAR1 overexpression, it happens through the this pathway, direct interaction of the BAR1 to the POP1. So somehow we are able to get the good results here, where we can, but this is only one example data set, one example. So we should look for the other further examples also. So this method is able to capture out what are the alternate ways for the routes can happen, and we can validate in this given scenario. Thank you.
Here you've used some gene expression data that people have found for different conditions, control and this thing.
Yeah, yeah.
Would there be any way of thinking of extending your methods to kind of make predictions for mutants where maybe one doesn't have that data? Is there some...
No, we can use...
You necessarily need that kind of microarray data before you can make a prediction.
No, so the thing is we can use this method. What we have done is that We just wanted to validate. This is just one example data set. Once we are able to, you know, we will be able to confident enough that, you know, that this information is correct and whatever predictions we are getting is close enough to correctness, we can use any type of data because it's just a data integration method. It's a protein-protein interaction network. So what we assume is that the gene expression is proportional to the protein expression.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, let's go on. Next group is by Dolly, Soumya, Tanvi, Zara, and Kalyani. Are everyone there? Kalyani is not there.
So we are a group of 5 people and we are looking at how does the temperature affect the immune cells during the influenza attack. So there was an existing literature where people had studied the transmission rate of influenza at the population level, and that depends on temperature. So these were the 2 articles which were suggesting and confirming that using in vivo and as well as the modeling approaches. However, there has not been any modeling done for the temperature dependence of the fitness of the immune systems. So if we are considering that the transmission rates are changing in the at the population level, there has to be some effect on the of the temperature on the immune system as well. But that has not been modeled yet. So before going into the deep detail, we'll just look at the mechanism of the virus attack. So this is when it happens at the normal body temperature, wherein the mucous membrane is the first line of defense. And when the virus is attacking the individual, the macrophages, which are playing a major role during the innate immune system, they will engulf the virus particles or any foreign particle and then clear off the foreign particle or the infection. And hence, most of the times, individuals won't even come across the infection. However, if it is able to bypass that particular first innate immune system, first line of defense, it will infect the nasal epithelial cell, which is the first lining of the nasal cells. So when it gains an entry, it actually, there is a mechanism by the host immune cells, wherein this particular RIG1 protein will be, which identifies the foreign single-stranded RNA, that is the genetic material of the virus, and it on the downstream signaling cascade upregulates the interferon gene expression. Now, once it does this, it actually activates the immune cells, and which will help in clearing of the viruses. When it goes to 33 degrees Celsius, which is a lower temperature, which is not a much difference, but has a very high effect on the immune cells, the mucous membrane, the first line of defense, is not there. So it directly gains entry to the cells, and the immune system will show how it is being affected because of the immune system being affected by the temperature. So this is what we have focused on. We have simplified it to the virion particle affecting the healthy cell, and it is becoming an infected cell, and it's activating an immune system. So how is this correlation based on the temperature will be will be explained by Tanvi.
Okay, so we all just, Dolly just explained the mechanism for the influenza. Our main aim was to mathematically model influenza. There has been a generic virus attack modeling by Novak and Price, and we introduced some additions to it to make it specific for the influenza case. And Jishi, so C, healthy cells, I, infected cells, F is the immune cells, and V is the virion particles that we model. This is the model which is essentially a more specialized version of the Novak Price model, which takes into account the birth rate of infection, where infected cells are, the rate of generation of infected cells depends upon the rate of infection, the number of healthy cells, and the number of virion particles. Then the rate of neutralization of infected particles by the immune cells is a cause of decrease in the number of virion, number of infected cells. Rate of neutralization of virion particles by the immune cells, rate of generation of the immune cells due to the number of variant particles. So this is a case where the number of immune cells increases when you have more virion particles present, which is when the immune cells are more active. So this is a factor which accounts for the increase in the number of immune cells with the presence of virion particles. Intrinsic death rate, and then the intrinsic death rate of all of these. This is the model that we introduced with some additions to the existing Nobel Prize model. However, there is still no temperature dependence in the model. We were not exactly sure how the temperature varies. This is just a generic model, some specification. Then, we were not sure how does the fitness of immune cells vary with temperature. We came across a paper where the fitness of RIG1 experimentally has been found to vary with temperature in this very recent paper by Foxman. They do an experimental analysis and they get that the catalytic rate of RIG1 has a kind of max peak at 37 degrees and decrease at 30 degrees and 42 degrees. Modeling this by a least square estimate, we get a curve like this. This is the fitted curve, as you can see. These are the essential data points that we have, and we fit a curve to this to get the exact temperature variation of the fitness of immune cells. Now, thus including the fitness of immune cells, if you do simulations of the number of infected cells and all the four variables that we had, we get a variation like this. As you can see, at a temperature of 30 degrees centigrade, the immune cells, the black line, decreases very fast and the virion particles goes on increasing. We did a simulation for a time scale of 100. Virion particles goes on increasing. However, at 37 degrees centigrade, the immune cells increases. The rate of the immune cells increases, and it's very high, much higher as compared to that at 30 degrees or 33 degrees. And the number of virion particles decreases below a certain level. Biologically, it might correspond to the viral attack being completely reduced. So, and a similar effect is also observed at 42 degrees centigrade virion is red and the immune cells are black. So at 30 degrees and 42 degrees, we expect the same dynamics to decrease as the fitness is decreases with temperature, and it's also very low at high temperature. And then if you plot the... These might not be very visible, but these is the infected cells normalized, the virion particles, the healthy cells, and the immune cells normalized. So, okay, there is an overlap for 42 degrees and 30 degrees centigrade, which is why there are only three curves visible here, although they are plotted for four temperatures. So there is an absolute overlap, which is what we got from the curve, from the figure that we had. At 37 degrees centigrade, you see that the infected cells have the minimum concentration. And that is at 37 degrees centigrade, the immune cells also have the maximum concentration. So in our study, we used a previous generic model for virus attack and modified it for influenza. And we incorporated temperature dependence for immune cells, which based on experimental evidence. And this seems to agree well with what we would expect theoretically. Further on, we could include intricate details to make it very specific for the immune system. This is where the whole mechanism of B cells and T cells coming into play for influenza attack would yield a more specific and better model, which would agree, if more experiments are carried out to determine the exact fitness, it would yield better results. And extensive details such as pathways could also be included. So with the flu season coming up, this was our essential motivation for studying the influenza model.
Which is the parameter or parameters here which are temperature dependent?
This one. Sorry. Omega, which is what we fit with the data points.
Yes, so you've, in this model, which is the model that you're using, mm-hmm. Some parameters are temperature dependent according to the curve that you showed. Yes. Which are those parameters?
Omega.
Just omega.
This is what we've modeled now, because it's a, as you can see, it's it's the rate of fitness of K cells. So we had to model it as a rate.
Okay. So just changing one parameter in this model and making it temperature dependent in this fashion gives you those different curves, right?
I didn't get the, so if you just show the next graph. So you fitted the, you have just four data points and you have this, what kind of curve did you fit?
A cubic function, which is what yielded the least minimum. A cubic function is what.
Okay. Maybe on Sanjay's question, how do you know the other parameters are not temperature dependent?
Because we didn't find any literature evidence for it.
Okay, fine.
Sorry. Yeah.
Like warm-blooded animals, maybe temperature variation is a little bit less important because you somehow maintain some temperature. But obviously for cold-blooded animals, this kind of temperature variation of rates and so on could be quite crucial, as you've shown. Is there any evidence that somehow the immune systems of cold-blooded animals have other ways to compensate for temperature? Presumably, like you've shown, particular catalysts will depend on temperature. And maybe warm-blooded animals have dealt with that by trying not to change the temperature too much. But cold-blooded animals, the temperature will change. Is there any evidence? Is there anything you've come across while you're reading?
Yeah, we did come across guinea pigs, but then they are warm-blooded. So
interesting to see what happens with cold-blooded animals.
Yeah, that's actually interesting. I'll write it down for further reference. Yeah.
Anything else? Okay, let's thank them. So maybe you try the groups we missed out in the morning. Dinakar, Esteban, Amisha, Emiliano, and Shubha. Are you here? Singh? Oh, there.